He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning. It's a new year. New semester. And we're that much closer to the Lord's return. And speaking of which, that's going to be our subject with President's Chapel today and with each one, the Judgment Seat of Christ, end time event. As we usually classify it. So this is going to be very interesting, very exciting. Better than normal. And so we're blessed to gather together, and we want to be sure we thank the Lord, acknowledge His presence. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as I lead us. Let's bow. Heavenly Father, thank You for Your great faithfulness, Your mercy, love, and Your presence that ministers hope and grace to us. And we acknowledge that we are worshiping You today, seeking to exalt Your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Enable us to worship You in the Spirit and then to receive the Word, and that it might be processed within each of our hearts and move us closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. As we sing and as we study and as we fellowship, we thank You for all that the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us to make this possible. And so we worship You today with thanksgiving. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Amen.
If you'll stand this morning, we're going to be singing at Calvary, remembering specifically what Jesus did for us on the cross, and then standing on the promises, knowing that one day He will return.
So while he's getting ready, say, I think everyone should sing loud. And I had a friend, he was a really good singer. He says, you know, if God's given you a good voice, you should sing loud and let God know that you really honor and praise Him. And if He didn't give you a good voice, you should sing loud and make Him feel sorry that He didn't give you a better voice.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me He died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. There was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Now I've given to Jesus everything, now I gladly own Him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf which God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great, and grace 'twas free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.
Good singing.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail. By the living word of God I shall prevail, and standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. On the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen. All right, good time. You mind a little humor? Somebody once said, far too many believers are not standing on the promises, they're sitting on the premises. Sorry. So my sermon today, I'm going to give you a kind of a little bit of a 10 or 12 minute background into why I chose this topic, kind of my story and how I got interested in it, okay? So I grew up in a really good church. A church that emphasized the study of future events as the Bible teaches them, Bible prophecy, eschatology. If you've been in the college for a little bit, you know that term. So we emphasized at our church eschatology, Bible prophecy. I mean, we didn't have revivals in our church. We had prophecy conferences a couple of times a year with some people that if I said their name, if you're old like me, you'd, oh, yeah, that's a big gun right there. That's the kind of church I grew up in. Went to Bible college, and a junior level course, required class at our Bible college, was Doctrine 301, eschatology. Spent the whole semester just talking about the future as the Bible describes it. Okay. Graduated from there. A few years later, went back to graduate school at the same college, and in my master's degree program, the very first
course I took, which was a required class, was called Dispensational Premillennialism. Which is a lot about the future and hermeneutics rolled into one, okay? Because the way you interpret the Bible really comes out with where you're going to think the Bible teaches we're going in the future, okay? So that was kind of my background. Went into ministry, became a pastor here in North Carolina in 1989, and I was raised this way, so when you are a pastor, you not only work on your sermon for this week, but you carve out some time to work on sermons that are like 2 or 3 months out there. So when you have one of those crazy weeks, you know, so 2 people die in the church and you need to do funerals, you've already done a lot of that stuff. So I'm working on sermons that are like months out. And I was going to do a sermon series on the future, prophecy, eschatology. Each one of them being expositional, but standalone topics like the rapture, the judgment seat of Christ, the second coming, the great white throne judgment, some of those kind of things. So I reached out to a dear friend of mine and I said, hey, Rick is his name. I'm going to do this sermon on the judgment seat of Christ. Have you got a book you'd recommend? And he said, yeah, here's a book. So I ordered. Now, this is going to date myself. This is before the internet. So you actually had to order a book, and a week or two later, who whistled? You had to actually wait a week or two for the book to come in. And this is in Southern Pines, North Carolina, so there was one little bookstore there. And about a week and a half later, they called me and said, Korver, your book's in. And it was one of those perfect weeks where I had a guest speaker, so all the time coming that Sunday, so all the time I normally would put in a sermon prep, I can just read this week. This is a perfect week if you love to read. And the book came in. And I got to tell you, it's a 600-plus page book. I got nothing to do. Started on a Tuesday morning, Wednesday night, I finished. It's like, this is unbelievable, okay? I mean, it absolutely turned my world upside down. Wow. And so I started reading other books about that topic. And Will won't know what this is. Somebody tell Will Hobbs what this is.
Eight-track.
It's not an 8-track. It's not a reel-to-reel. This is a cassette tape, okay? Some of you know the pain I'm about to describe. So I got this thing about 6 months later. And it was this guy named Earl Rodmacher's story about how he kind of came along to this topic. And so I'm listening in my car and in my office at the church and so forth, and he would say something about a book. And he'd be like, you know, Rand Dahlinger wrote a book on blah, blah, blah. I'm thinking, wait, what did you say? Books and books and books. And then did my doctoral dissertation on this topic. It just changed who I am, okay? So here's my hope, that God would use today's sermon and the next 4 in this semester to light that kind of fire in your life. It really changed who I am. Now, I got to be honest with you. You ever had somebody recommend a book to you and you buy the book and you get about 15 pages and you think, this is the most boring book I've ever read in my life? Yes? Okay. So that's what happened for me. This was one of those need to know, need to grow sort of times in my life. Like if I said to I'm picking on Will today. If I said to Will, here's a great book on child raising. He's thinking, child raising? I'm 18. I don't have any kids. He's not interested in that topic. Does that make any sense? So the book, I'm not going to even tell you the name of the book that turned my life upside down, but if you want it later, I'll be glad to give you the title. But it was one of those moments for me and seasons that kind of started that. All right? So here's my not only sermon today, but for the next 5 months in a nutshell. One day, the King of Kings will evaluate your life. That's the whole ball of wax in one sentence for the next 5 months or so. The King of Kings, and who is he?
Jesus
Christ will evaluate your life. All right? So what are some fundamental, some foundational truths that we need to know related to that coming evaluation? Well, there's lots of passages in the Bible. We're just going to look at one this morning. So if you would take your copy of God's Word, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to look at just 2 verses, chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. Now, remember, students at CCBS, context is what?
King.
Here's the context. Obviously, Paul's second letter to the church at Corinth. If you ever get a chance to start a church, don't name it Corinth. Corinth Baptist, Corinth Independent, Corinth anything, because they were the worst church in the New Testament. He wrote a letter. Now, obviously, this is his second letter. they had given a lot of pushback to Paul's ministry, so it's the most autobiographical letter that Paul ever wrote. A lot of the stuff defending his ministry and so forth. Well, you get to chapter 4. We're not going to be in chapter 4, but chapter 4, verses 16 to 18, Paul talks about suffering. You know, you can suffer for Jesus. A lot of folks did in his day. Paul suffered greatly. He talks about it pretty good length in 2 Corinthians, about being shipwrecked and beaten and stoned and all those kind of things. And you can suffer other ways too, just physical health, right? Either way, you know, suffering, y'all can talk in my sermon. You realize suffering often results in this thing called death. Okay, so Paul brings up this topic of suffering, which often leads to death. Okay, that's end of chapter 4. You get to chapter 5, and Paul talks about this idea of death, and he says, you know what? Paraphrasing verses 1 to 8, he says, you know, this body we have on this earth before glorified body is like a tent. You know, when you go tent camping, you don't plan to spend a long time there, right? Although some of us don't think tent camping ought to be allowed, right? Holiday Inn or better. That's where I'm going, okay? But you have a tent, which is temporary, versus a house, which is permanent. So Paul contrasts a tent versus a house, okay? And he talks about death. He's okay, and he got famous verse used a lot of times at sermon, to be absent from the body is to present with the Lord. So Paul's brought up death, suffering in chapter 4, death in chapter 5. Now, he doesn't bring it up here, but I'm convinced that the return of Christ could happen any moment. That's called imminence. Jesus could come back today. Either way, guess what? Here's the news. Someday, your life's going to be over. Can y'all do this for me? Yeah. Rapture or death, so everybody in here, your life's going to be over sometime. If the Lord chooses not to come back 50 years from now, I'm not going to be here. Probably a lot sooner than that. Okay? So he's talking about the end of life. And guess what? At the end of life, there's going to come this thing called an evaluation. So that's where Paul goes now in chapter 5, verses 9 and 10. So here's my first point. You ready for points if you like taking points? If you're in Dickerson's exposition class or whatever, you can start marking me up like he didn't do that right or whatever. In light of this any moment return and the evaluation you'll have by Jesus, here's the first idea. It's a great ambition to do well there, or just put a great ambition. Verse 9. Therefore, now you've had hermeneutics, right? Yeah. When you see a therefore, what's it there for? In other words, he just talked about suffering and death and the end of life. And because of that, here's a connection to that. Therefore, also we have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him. Paul has an ambition. In other words, in my New American Standard, the word ambition there only used two times in the New Testament, both by Paul. Once about some other people, he says to them, this should be your ambition, to lead a quiet life, just mind your own business sort of life. Don't stick your nose in everybody else's business. But this is the only place Paul uses it about himself. He said, here's my ambition. Okay. Now, by the way, the word he uses for ambition there means to strive for, to set as a goal. In other words, Paul says, here's my goal. Here's what I work really hard for. Great. Now, we'll come back to that in just a second. But I want you to think about this. So what are our ambitions, if we're really, really honest? What are our ambitions? And these are not necessarily bad ambitions. We're starting a new semester this week. Yesterday you started. Some of you have as an ambition to get an A in the class. That was really weak. You don't want an A. Okay. We want to get an A in a class, or maybe just a passing grade. My ambition in high school was just to be mediocre and just get out of class. Okay. I was a very underachiever. But some of us have an ambition to get an A in class. All right. You might have an ambition to graduate from CCBS. Yes. Retention guy really wants you to do that. Yes. Stay in class. You know, get your degree. Great. Some of us, really honestly, my ambition is to get a new and then fill in the blank. A new house, a new vehicle, a new toy, whatever toys, hobbies you have. My ambition is, man, if I could just get that, life would be good. Okay. My ambition is to travel to, and you've got this bucket list. Come on, don't tell me you don't like traveling anywhere. Maybe your ambition is to travel home and never be around people. I don't know, but you have some kind of ambition. All right. My ambition is to grow my ministry to X. You want to be the pastor of the biggest church in Cumberland County or whatever. big, the pastor, the youth pastor of the biggest youth group, whatever. Well, not a bad thing necessarily.
Okay.
My ambition is to make, and then fill in the amount of money you want to make next year. My ambition is to, like, whatever it is, that much more. Okay. My ambition is to get promoted. A lot of former military people here, you know, want to get promoted to this rank. And when I get to that rank, then I want to get promoted to that rank. And it could be in the secular world, I want to get promoted to manager, then district manager, then vice president, then president, and then, okay. None of those are necessarily bad ambitions. Would you agree with that?
Right.
Got it. So do y'all remember 20-some years ago? Sorry, Will. A guy named Rick Warren wrote a book called The Purpose-Driven Life.
Yeah.
It absolutely sold tens of millions of copies. It was such a bestseller internationally, they translated it into multiple languages. Okay. And so in pondering this sermon and that book, I've pondered this before. I wonder what it would be like if you could get in a time machine and go back 2,000 years and say to the Apostle Paul, what's your ambition in life? What's your purpose-driven life? What would that look like, Paul? Now, you can speculate all you want to. Here's what I would tell you very confidently. You don't need to speculate because he told us right here, here's my only ambition, not one of several. My only, that's the only place Paul uses the word in the whole New Testament. What does he say his ambition is? Well, look back in verse 9. Therefore, we have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, meaning home with the Lord or absent from the Lord, to be what? Here's Paul's ambition. I didn't make it up. Paul's ambition is this. He said, I got one goal in life, to be pleasing to Jesus. That's it. Now, by the way, those ambitions we talked about a little bit ago, you realize some of those, in fact, probably all of those, could come underneath that. But you could accomplish all those and that not be your goal. For example, you know, there's a really famous university here in the United States that the president just retired because of plagiarism. I could say as a student, I'm not a student, I could say as a student, my goal is to get an A in this class. And I could plagiarize a paper and it go undetected and I get an A in the class. Great, I got my goal. Does that please Jesus? No, not in a million years. I get promoted because I cheat or I lie, whatever. Okay, does that please Jesus? No, a promotion that you got that way doesn't please Jesus. I get promoted at the military, but I did a couple of things that were shady to get the promotion. That doesn't please Jesus. That makes sense? Paul's ambition is one thing, that he would please Jesus. Okay. Rhetorical question here. In light of that day, by the way, just a quick thought. I got way more things that I have to say than I have time to say them. It's attributed to D.L. Moody, but perhaps before him, about the judgment seat of Christ. D.L. Moody said he had two days on his calendar, today and that great day. Mm-hmm. And when you have that day on your calendar, it changes the way you live today. Mm-hmm. Okay? So in light of Paul's ambition, again, but rhetorical, perhaps your ambition or ambitions need to be changed or altered. Paul said, I got one. At the end of life, whenever this evaluation takes place, Jesus would say, well done. Well done. Be pleasing to him. Here's an anonymous quote I have. Hanging up in my office, I cannot say I always practice it, but I see it daily. Ready for the quote? It doesn't matter if the world knows or sees or understands. The only applause we are meant to seek is that of nail-scarred hands. That's it. But here's the way we live life. I want people to like me. So I think, oh, if I preach a really good sermon at chapel, they'll all go, and I get applause. Now, it's not wrong to applaud people. It's not wrong to praise people. But that shouldn't be my goal at all. It changes the way you do ministry when you think, you know what? Is Jesus going to be pleased with this? Because if Jesus isn't pleased with it, I don't care what else we do. It's worthless.
Amen.
So, okay, that brings a question to my mind. So, how in the world will I know if my life is pleasing to him? Paul says, my ambition is to be pleasing to him. How will I know, how will you know, if your life is pleasing to the Lord? Okay,
well, there's some other things too, but this is a short passage. It will be because of the summons before the Lord. Look, here's my second point.
great ambition. Number two, a certain summons. All right?
Verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. That first phrase, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ.
The all in the context is believers. Remember, context is king, right? So I could say all my students flunked a class or flunked a test. Well, some of you aren't my students. You're not in my spiritual formation class. That's kind of important. We summarize who the all is, right? Okay. The all in the context are believers in Jesus Christ. All. Okay. Every believer. This has nothing to do with lost people, unsaved people. That's a different story for a different time. Well, notice the next phrase.
We must, right? We must all appear. That's why I call it a certain summons.
Because of my role here at the college, I get invitations every week to RSVP for things. If you don't know this, CCBS is accredited by the Association for Biblical Higher Education, ABHE. ABHE is overseen by the U.S. Department of Education. So there are literally thousands of colleges and universities in the United States, right? And because of our accreditation through ABHE, which is underneath the umbrella of the U.S. Department of Education, colleges out there have access to a database to know who the presidents are of every college in the United States, okay? So literally every week, I get an invitation to attend an inaugural ceremony for a president of a college at a place I've never heard of. Y'all with me so far? And guess what I do with all those RSVPs?
Don't have trash.
They're snail mail. So it's awesome. I think, I don't even know where that is. And by the way, they're usually asking for money too. Hey, would you get a table for $1,000 and bring your team with you? Okay. I ignore them. Y'all ever get invitations in the mail that you think, oh, yeah, I'm kind of busy. I don't really want to do that. Sure. You're asked to RSVP, but you're thinking, nah, I'm not that interested. Maybe you really are busy, or maybe it's just an event you don't want to be a part of. I'm good. You don't RSVP for that. Okay. Well, here's a piece of news for you. Jesus isn't going to say, excuse me, I'd like to see you. And you say, eh, I'd rather not. The passage says we must all appear. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's a certain summons. Okay.
We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. I can't say I'm busy.
I'm kind of uninterested, or truth be known, I'm a little bit nervous about that. Not going to work. We must all appear. All, again, believers in Christ.
Let me just tell you real quick, so this is a brand new material for perhaps some of you.
Let me tell you what the judgment seat of Christ is not. Sometimes the way to define things is what it's not versus what it is. Here's a couple of things about the judgment seat, what it is not.
It is not a time to determine a person's eternal destiny. Let me say it again. It is not a time to determine a person's eternal destiny.
Put it another way, it is not a heaven or hell sort of moment. Can y'all say that? It's neither heaven or this. A person who appears before the judgment seat of Christ has zero, zilch, nada, I would say in other languages if I knew them, zero chance of ever going to hell. Zero. Okay? So it's nothing to do with where a person spends eternity. Some of you might be thinking, well, wait a minute, Dr. Kate. I thought all my sins were forgiven when I trusted in Jesus, because God the Father punished Jesus on the cross and he gave me everlasting life and forgiveness of sins when I believed the gospel. Absolutely true. So this has, look up here a minute, I'll make it bigger, zero to do with your sin. That makes sense? Okay, wonderful. That's what the judgment seat is not.
Okay. So if that's what it's not, well then what is it? Well, that's a pretty good question. A couple of generalities, give you some specifics.
The judgment seat in the Bible time, New Testament times, was basically a platform. The word dais, D-I-A-S, or think of now in modern times, a bench. Now, don't vote out loud on this. Some of you have been in a courtroom before on the wrong side, right? I've been there a few times as a potential juror, okay? And I've watched plenty of TV. And they do this on purpose, so they have the judge, him or her, in a big black robe typically, and their bench is raised. It's kind of intimidating. You know, you're 6'1", but that judge behind the bench, and you're kind of looking up at him and her, right? This raised platform, okay? Well, that's what it was in the New Testament. By the way, Pilate, the guy who tried Jesus, we're told in Matthew 27 that he was seated on the judgment seat. Herod in Acts 12, before he died, had a judgment seat. And Gallio in Acts 18 had this thing called a judgment. It's just a place where a judge could sit and hear a case. And from that place, he or she could render a judgment. Okay? Now, it's also used in the athletic sense. This is better, right? You want to get out of the courtroom, right? Okay. And so in the athletic sense, here's what would happen. There would be judges in the stands in the audience, and they would observe the contestants to see if the contestants competed according to the rules. Y'all have heard stories about marathoners and people who cheat, right? Mm-hmm. They cut the course and they come in record time and realize, oh, they ran the Boston Marathon so fast because they only ran 18 miles, not 26 miles, mm-hmm. right? So at that point, what does the judge or judges do? They disqualify them from the prize. They don't disqualify them from living. You want to run another race, fine, but you get disqualified from a prize in this race. Okay, so courtroom or athletic contest were common in those days. So to render a verdict, yes, but on the athletic side, well, true in the courtroom side too, to distribute a prize. Imagine being the person, you've watched enough Olympics where the gold medalist comes and represents his or her country. They put a gold medal around them. Okay. Imagine having somebody, not just a judge, but Jesus, the King of Kings, do something good for you. That's the possibility of the Bema. Well, look at the my last point, the possible reward. Verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That's a certain summons. Well, how come? That each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So we're going to be evaluated, not sins, but on what basis? Deeds done in the body. Now here's what I think. When he says deeds done in the body, he's not saying deeds that you did in your physical body, because every deed you've ever done has been in your physical body. I've never done a deed outside the body, right? Here's what I think he means. Deeds done in this body while in the body of Christ. So the idea is from the moment you got saved until either the rapture happens or you're dead, one or the other. That make sense so far? Okay. Deeds done in the body. Okay. Those will be evaluated. Well, then he tells us this. He says there's two kinds of deeds. He kind of gives a broad summary here. Deeds, whether good or bad. Okay. Well, the good ones there, that word good means good or kind. Good as God defines it. Now here's the word for bad. You say, wait a minute, Korver, you told me that sin wasn't going to come up. I'm confident it won't. The word bad here means worthless or of no value. Okay. Now, do you realize that sometimes we can do good deeds with bad motives? And then the Lord would render about those are of no value, because they were, while good in principle, they were bad in motive. Let me give you a quick example of that. Remember in Matthew 6, Jesus said this about the Pharisees. When they give alms to the poor, all of us would agree that giving to poor people is a good thing to do, right? A person who legitimately has a need, it's nice to give to them, right? Okay, so that's one thing they did. He said also they fast. The church I attend is doing a fasting thing this week, okay? By the way, that's the least practiced spiritual discipline on the planet, at least in America, right? We like to eat. So fasting, everybody would agree fasting is not a bad thing, right? Right. And then finally he said praying. We all agree that praying is a great thing. Now here's the problem in each of those three cases. Jesus said about the Pharisees, they give alms to be seen. They fast and put on a long face. And you say, oh, gee, Anthony, what are you looking kind of bad, buddy? And he says, oh, I'm fasting for Jesus. Been fasting for 3 days. Okay. And they pray. Well, guess what? When they time to pray, they would make sure they were on a busy corner. Let's just say Skybo and Rayford Road. 12 o'clock noon. Make sure you're planted right there. All these cars driving by. And they pray this prayer. Oh, look at Corey. He's such a godly guy. Look at him praying there on the corner. And here's what I find fascinating. Jesus didn't say about the Pharisees, they don't get a reward. In fact, he said three times, they have the reward in full. Mm-hmm. You get a reward when you do things for the wrong reason. Yeah. And here's the reward from people. Remember, we're supposed to be seeking the applause of nail-scarred hands, not people. And so should we give? Sure. Should we fast? Sure. Should we pray? Yes, but with the right motives. So it can be a really good thing, but when done with bad motives, the king's going to say someday, nah, worthless. It's like a piece of rotten fruit. I like bananas, especially this week with the Daniel fast. And to me, the greener the banana, the better. That's just me, right? Like they're almost impossible to peel. You know what I'm talking about? Okay, that to me is a perfect banana. And when a banana gets about, you know, like brownish, blackish skin on it, where it's just like, now this is Korver, okay? To me, that's a worthless, bad, toss it in the trash banana, okay? And so in part, maybe you don't agree with my choice of bananas, right? But in part, that's what the Lord thinks about sometimes when we do good things with a bad motive. That's just like a squishy, rotten, putrid piece of fruit. No, toss that. No. Not pleasing to me. So, question. So what kind of works, he says good works, what kind of works does a person have to do to be rewarded? I mean, big things, as we qualify big, like preaching chapel the first, you know, week of the month, or teach an adult Bible study, or lead a small group, or be like Billy Graham and share, when he was still living, share the gospel with thousands and thousands of people. What do you have to do to possibly get rewards? Or if you're into finances, give a really major gift to CCBS. No, while those things might be rewarded or rewardable, it's any act done for Jesus' glory with the right motive. Let me give you a verse. Matthew chapter 10, verse 42. You don't have to turn there. Here's what Jesus said. He said, if you give a cup of cold water to somebody who's thirsty in my name, I'll give you a reward for that. Now, this is not a trick question. Go ahead and vote out loud if you want to. Do you have the capacity to fill a cup of water and give it to somebody who's thirsty? Yes. See, this is not rocket science. We don't have to do these great works to be rewarded. It's just simply doing something good, as God defines good, with the right motive. And he's a meticulous record keeper. If you haven't learned this already, you'll learn this in theology about God's knowledge. He's omniscient. Which means what? He knows everything, never forgets anything. Right. Now think about that in this future day. Whenever you got saved, to whenever this day happens, every little cup of cold water, every little pat on the back, everything you did that was God-honoring and for the right motive, he'll reward that.
Wow. By the way, look back in verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may be, my New American Standard says, recompensed or receive. The word recompense, receive what is due, the ESV says it. It's something that's due, but it's due because God promised it,
which is very different than me saying to God, hey, you owe me. No. If I'm owed anything by God, it's because God made a promise and he always keeps his promise. Remember we've talked about standing on the promises? Mm-hmm. Now I have some employees here at the college. Who could I pick on? Dr. Phillips? All the other staff voted yes on that one. So when I hired Dr. Phillips, I said to him, on behalf of the college, we will pay you. Now, whose decision was that? So at the end of a pay period, let's just say the 15th of the month, and Dr. Hovater, soon to be Dr. Hovater, doesn't do his job right, and it makes the 16th and 17th and the funds haven't hit Dr. Phillips' account. Would Dr. Phillips be out of place to say, hey, Dr. K, could I, you made a promise, and could I see that come forth? No, he's not out of place, because I made him a promise. And here's what Jesus is telling people like you and me. I'm making you some promises. Here's one of them. You do things for my honor and my glory, and I will reward you. Whose idea was it? It's not my idea. It's his idea. Okay. So he says, at this future time, you'll receive what is due you. Why is it due you? Because he made a promise. And now you're just collecting on his promise. I'm showing my age here, but here we go anyway. When I was a kid, it was very popular to get these things called Cracker Jacks.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, they came in a box back in the day. Yeah. I think they come in a bag now, but they were a box back then. And this is really showing my age. When I was real little, you could get it for a nickel. I think it went to a dime. We thought it was highway robbery. But anyway, Cracker Jacks. And they advertised on TV, but they advertised on every last box. There's a prize inside.
Yeah.
Some of you don't even know what Cracker Jacks are, do you?
No.
Caramel corn with, they would, it's kind of like pork and beans. There was like one peanut in the bottom. Okay. But anyway, little box, and had this prize in it. So you rip the top of the box off, and if you were like all the other people, you'd kind of, the box that went, reach for that prize, okay? I cannot tell you how many dozens of boxes of Cracker Jacks I have consumed in my life, always convinced of this. This time, the prize will be worth it. Never, ever. The prize was terrible, terrible. I'm just whetting your appetite for the future, but here's a question for you. Jesus makes a promise, but he's going to reward your service sometime. Now, the question is the prize, is the reward really worth all the effort? And I could tell you in a word, absolutely. Future times, if Jesus doesn't come back first and he lets me live that long, we'll talk about what they might be. But let me whet your appetite a little bit right now. The Bible talks extensively about crowns. You know what kind of people wear crowns? Kings and queens. And there's a reason why Jesus is called the King of Kings. It implies he's number one, yes, but there are others beside him. That could well be you. Honor. All of us have heard this at funeral services, perhaps more than we should have. It's like the way it's often presented. Jesus says to every last person who ever died, well done, good and faithful servant. Some of the services I've been thinking, who are you describing, right? Here's something I learned a long time ago. Jesus always gives undeserved salvation. He never gives undeserved praise. Let me say that again. He always gives undeserved salvation. That's called grace. He never gives undeserved praise. That's a lie. Quick story. Suppose you're in my class. You write the most abysmal paper in my class. I am not being honest with you if I, at the end of the semester, say, that was a great paper. No, the terrible paper. You ought to get a D on it or an F or whatever. Just being honest. Jesus always gives deserved praise, but never undeserved praise. So crowns, honor, position of service. Rule over these cities for a minute. And a commendation. Wow, a commendation. We're not going to go there. We'll steal somebody's thunder. Revelation 3 says he's going to commend a person who's an overcomer before the Father and the holy angels. Wow. Imagine Jesus hushing all the angels in heaven and saying about you, this is my faithful servant. Wow. That's some of the rewards that are possible. Here's the summary real quick. Life is going to come to an end, either by death or the rapture. And you're going to be evaluated by Jesus, sooner or later. Is it your highest ambition to be pleasing to him? If it's not, my suggestion is early in 2024, reevaluate your ambitions. Because you're going to be summoned. It's not just going to invitation you can toss. I don't mean this to be mean, but Jesus is going to say, let's talk. And the point of the judgment seat of Christ is not fear. Here's the positive point. The point of the judgment seat of Christ is that the King of Kings can reward you for every last thing you ever did for him, and he forgets nothing. Robert Moffat, a name you probably don't know, he was a Greek scholar. He was a father-in-law to the famous missionary David Livingstone. Here's a quote. I have this one in my office too, and a few years ago we gave this quote etched in stone to all of our major donors. Robert Moffat, quote, "We have all eternity to celebrate our victories, but we have only one short hour before sunset in which to win them." You get 70, 80 years, maybe. And eternity is going to be millions and billions and billions. Whatever you do now, you're going to relate to your honor, your commendation, and your rewards in the future.
Our love for Jesus ought to motivate us, absolutely. But also, in addition to our love for him for what he's done, it's the certain evaluation and the possibility of him rewarding me and you ought to motivate us as well. Let me leave us in a word of prayer.
Father, we are grateful for your word. Thank you for warning us ahead of time that there's an evaluation coming. And may we, with the Apostle Paul, say that my one ambition, my highest ambition, I might have other ambitions, but they're way insubordinate, way lower than that one. My highest ambition is to be pleasing to Christ. Lord, we're going to know that. Sometimes we'll know that in this life when we don't do what pleases you, our conscience convicts us, but we're really going to know it when you evaluate us. May it be said of each one of us, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord. Help us to live that way. Pray that we, like D.L. Moody, would have 2 days on our calendar, today and that great day. Pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. And so the President's Chapel, each time for this semester, will be on this subject, the Judgment Seat of Christ. And this was a great foundation to diving into that subject, and one that's not covered enough as a rule. So it's going to be real exciting. Now, in connection with that subject, the other faculty speakers are going to be covering Revelation chapters 1 through 3. And Dr. Korver quoted an appropriate connection, and so I think it'll be a good combination. And thus, next Tuesday, a week from today, Lord willing, Dr. McCuddy will open up with Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Now, this is the first week of a new semester, and the Student Senate is providing some nice sweet treats. Yesterday was ice cream. If you weren't here yesterday and there's still some left over in the freezer, you can help yourself. Just only to one, though. Just only to one. Today is pastries. Tomorrow you get a gift bag if you come here on campus. And Thursday is pizza, so that's really awesome. And then on Saturday, the Student Senate, in connection with our alumni, are invited as well. But all students are invited, and any guests you would like to bring, as long as they're 15 years of age and older. This Saturday, 1 o'clock, they're going to show a movie, have a time of fellowship, and then conclude that time with prayer. And the movie is Unbroken, which the subtitle says, a World War II story of survival, resilience, and redemption. You might be familiar with, and it's a very good learning experience in watching that. So this Saturday at 1 o'clock, it is helpful if you might RSVP. It's not required, but it's helpful, and your emails saw a link where you can do that. Time of fellowship, watching the movie, and then a time of prayer this Saturday here on campus at 1 o'clock. As you receive your syllabus for each of your classes this week, don't be overwhelmed. Process that in the grace of God and just be found faithful through those times. Remember, you have tutor.com at your disposal 24/7, peer tutors out of the library. And then let's remember our donations for the South Africa trip led by Dr. McCuddy and fellow students. Let's fill the box. Let's empty the box. Let's fill it again. You can also make donations through Dr. McCuddy's ministry online, Families of Virtue. Now, due to the weather today, here's the schedule for the remaining classes. Your 1 o'clock classes are going to meet as normal. Then at 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock today, those round of classes will be by Zoom only. So no classes here on campus today beginning at 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock, 7 o'clock, Zoom only. Hopefully you'll have electricity and we'll be able to have that time of remote learning, but at least you don't have to try to be out getting over here and getting back home. But let's do remember that in prayer. Anything else? All right, let's thank the Lord again and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for your goodness and the message we heard today. May it just infiltrate our hearts and our minds. Lord, that's our desire. And we want to focus on that all the more to see our lives be used of you in such a way that it bring more honor and glory to you. We do pray for our students. The first week can be very challenging mentally. May they find your grace sufficient in the moment. And we know that it will also take us through this time period. Enable them, Lord, to have that level of dedication that they'll continue on with great progress in their degree plan, seeking to serve you now and in the future until you return and bring us home. So bless them, I pray, and meet their needs accordingly. And we'll ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Very good.